So we'll start with this important aspect of mechatronic systems, which is selection of sensors and actuators. We have done the modeling so far, so we need to use this model to now get to some of these estimation of sensor parameters or sensor specifications that we need to get to, and actuator specifications. So we'll see some relationship and some interesting ways of computing the sensor, or computing or arriving at specification of sensors and actuators. I'll talk about a little bit more detail in the sense we may not have to do entire simulations to kind of get to this, but we can do some kind of ballpark estimations of the parameters in some way. So as we go along, we'll talk. So let me get into the slideshow mode here. Okay, now we first bother about what are the interfaces for sensors and actuators, and we have seen already couple of interfaces. So PWM, you may have DA, digital analog converter for actuator, or say simple digital output for actuators like solenoid. Okay, for sensors you may have ADC, analog to digital conversion interface, that we are yet to see that. In TIBA we may see at some point, or you may take it in the project. Digital input outputs we have seen for sensors, again we can use that. And encoder interface, as QEI interface we have programmed, and you may use UART in some cases where the data from sensors is available in UART kind of a form already processed, and you get only the numbers in the microcontroller. Okay, what are the important considerations for development of this sensor actuator specifications? Is first, whatever are the system requirements, like what is the requirement for your control application or mechatronics application, that we need to know first. Okay, or we need to kind of given the abstract problem, we arrive at those requirements first, and then we move on to sensor requirements. Okay, so we map them to the sensor requirements, and for this mapping we'll need a modeling for the system. Okay, so what we have seen in the different forms of models, like Lagrangian formulation is one of the thing, or Newtonian formulation. So whatever, these models that we are doing some mathematical development, that can be used for this map. Okay, in fact that should be used for this map, because then we'll be able to kind of very clearly get all the necessary specifications, and we don't over design actuators or sensors. Okay, so for that you need this kinematic dynamic analysis to get to do that. Then other thing is you need to make sure that about the noise considerations. Now system specifications will be in terms of some resolution of positioning that is required, or resolution of some whatever output that is required, and we need to make sure in the presence of noise we get that kind of a requirement satisfied. And noise, so you need to see what is the noise in the environment around it, and what is to be done to suppress the noise, and some kind of a filtering that may need to be done. All those kind of things are to be accounted for. We'll dwell more about noise a little later actually. So you need to keep this in mind when we develop the sensor specifications. Okay, then you can have a choice of analog versus digital. So mostly the recommendation is to go for digital sensors for making sure that noise consideration is not bothering too much actually. And analog you'll do only in cases where you don't have any option for the digital sensor. For example, strain gauge to sense, You typically will go for analog strain gauges. There is no digital output for the strain gauges. So you use that and amplified output of that. Then you need to kind of bother about some noise filtering, and then use that data from ADC channel to convert. Then you'll need to, of course, match the interfaces and its compatibility in its interface specifications. For example, if you are using encoder interface and you have some range, say 50-60 mm, and some resolution for encoder, then you get a number of bits. So the number of bits of the encoder channel should match the range requirement for you. So number of numbers that are getting represented within that range, say 0 to 60 mm, I want to kind of go, and I have a resolution of maybe 0.01 mm, or like, you know, that is one encoder count, or that's what if it is given, then one can estimate how many number of numbers that will get represented from going from 0 to 600. 0 to 60 mm, and then correspondingly I would have a number of bits estimated, and like say that, okay, our encoder channel must have minimum these number of bits to kind of get the sensing done properly, so that within that range I don't have to have deal with this number overflow situation scenario. Then of course, use of filters I talked about for you know, noise consideration, one has to do that. And then filter has another implication for increasing your sampling time, okay, because the filter calculations have to happen within the sampling instance. So again, those details we'll talk a little more in the future, okay. There is another thing that, okay, you need to think about whether you want analog filter or digital domain filter to be done. Analog domain filter and digital, so this filter discussion will reserve for the future part, okay. When you go for digital domain filter, then only like you'll have to do computations in the microcontroller. In analog domain filter, you may not need to reserve a time in the sampling time for filter calculations. Then of course, cost implications, and then you can do this mathematical modeling and do the preliminary simulations to get to the sensor requirements or actuator requirements, okay. And then of course, one has to see the manufacturer's catalog to do the proper choices, because you may not find exactly of all the specifications you have drawn, and the sensors may not be available, but there'll be some conservative, like, you know, you'll have some sensors which are beyond satisfying all these specifications and having some more kind of you know, additional features. We can go for that, okay. So we need to have this minimum estimation done and then choose something which is better than that. That is how we choose from the manufacturer's catalog, okay. So let's take an example of a linear motion stage, and then work about how do we get going for the specifications here. So you have a say motor stage, we consider like, you know, lead screw configuration, which with spring-loaded elements for so when we have such a kind of a system, motion stage with a lead screw, and we have given this problem, okay. So we would like to have this closed loop control implementation, okay, for such a stage, such that the drive accuracy is about 5 micron, and speed of operation to be achieved is about 20 mm per second, and range is given to be 60 mm. So what should be sensor and actuator specification? So this is like a typical problem that could be appearing. Some of the data may be given, some of the data may be missing, and you need to kind of make assumption or make a reasonable assumption for the application that is required. So this is, now we are given this already, so this may not be in this form. Some people may give, okay, oh look, I want to use this stage for biological slide scanning purpose, okay. Now only with this kind of a specification given, you need to ask some more questions to the to the people for whom you are kind of developing this stage, and get to know, like, you know, what are the more detailed specifications that they require in terms of design. Okay, so these design specifications arriving at is based on the what is the requirement for a user of the application. Then we will need to get for more detailed kind of now sensor specification. So here you, based on this data given, one can kind of now come up with say, okay, if I mount this sensor on my motor side, and then there is a lead screw. The lead screw will have some specifications of, like, you know, lead for one rotation is say 1 mm, 2 mm, some kind of a specification. Then one can say, okay, for motion of 5 micron, I'll need to have some kind of a kinematics estimated to see, okay, how this 5 micron on the lead screw side, okay, or on the motion side, like, you know, linear motion side, translate to the rotary motion side. Okay, that you can do very easily by using some kind of a you know, simple kinematics. Okay, so that kind of a estimation needs to be done. So to get to actual sensor specifications, then another thing, like, for example, to get to actuator specifications, one has to kind of do some kind of a think about some kind of a dynamics. Okay, so we'll get to that. Okay, what are the moving masses in the system and things like that. Okay, so I'll give you some kind of a broad outline of the process that can be followed. So where to start? I mean, you know, again, all these things will be little bit of a common sense if you keep it active, like, things will be falling in place. So how do we go about doing this? What do you think? Just think about, like, okay, suppose you are given these specifications, and now you want to get to the sensor and actuator specifications. As we have seen, like, you know, considering this lead screw, one can kind of get to a little bit of kinematics. So I'll just give you some broad outline of the process that you'll follow. I mean, it's just a common sense. I mean, if you think, okay, there are some additional steps that can be done, it's just all up to you. Okay, so see, first, like, you know, you can do this physical construction of system in sketch and observe, like, you know, what are the kinematic connections and relationships. Okay, this is very simple for this linear motion stage, but it may get into a little bit more complexity for more complicated kind of problems. So we'll see say similar kind of a thing. One more example of two-hour manipulator to get to this kind of a discussion. So then now you can get sensor resolution and range specification based on these kinematic relationships. As I said, for, like, given the specification 5 micron on X side motion, how much it translates to the rotary motion for the sensor. And typically, if 5 micron is a resolution, and corresponding to that you have estimated resolution on the motor theta side, you'll need to be better than that from the digital control perspective, because if 5 micron is so, let's say corresponding to 5 micron, let's say it's some alpha angle on the motor side. Now, if you select sensor which is exactly of this alpha resolution, okay, then the problem is that, like, your control is happening every sampling instance, and then there are many different kind of other elements that are there. For example, some of the noise considerations. Noise in this case would be, like, you know, it's a digital sensor. If you select, then noise from the sensor may not be there, but there'll be some kind of a friction in the system which will affect the positioning resolution. Okay, so there are the errors that are there in the positioning that will happen based on some kind of a dynamics of a system that need to get accounted for in the resolution. Okay, so we need a better resolution than alpha and it is typically like 1/4 or 1/5 of alpha that we can go for. So it's very hard to get single count of, so when we say resolution is alpha, it's a single count of the sensor which is alpha. So one count, within one count you get to the accuracy. It's a very hard problem to solve from digital control perspective. So you may be better off by solving up to two or three times it's comfortable to solve. Like, so your resolution is alpha by three for the sensor, and what you get after, the closed loop control is alpha. That scenario I'm talking about. And why that happens, we can see some part in the simulation. See, there are many different error inducing that happens along the different elements in the whole of the path of control. Okay, so one of them is, like, say you can see the sensor quantization. The quantization aspect will have some kind of effect on the dynamics. Like that, there are the noise I have talked about, then like the friction I have talked about. So from this perspective, like, you need a better kind of resolution than your estimate of what is required from the user specification or application specifications. Okay, so this is an important point to note here, and one has to kind of see, to get to that exactly, it's a hard problem. Okay, so one can work with this ballpark kind of estimates that comes based on mainly a kind of experience, that okay, you are able to kind of position within, like, so when we are within, say, 3 to 4 times, like, the resolution of the sensor actually is there. So that's why, like, your sensor resolution needs to be little better than what you get by just this kinematic relationships estimate. Okay, and that typical number is maybe 3 or 4 times better. Then you can note this other step that you follow is, like, noting, like, moving elements in the system, and give some rough estimates of what is their mass and other stuff. Then they can be kept as a variables sometimes, depend upon, like, what is the application that you are dealing with. Then you can determine the equivalent inertia or load, inertia and load on motor that is coming, and then this will help to get the motor specifications done. Okay, now the motor specifications would come not by, like, you can, one way you can go about is simulate entire kind of a process of whatever you want to achieve. Little cumbersome. But you can get simple ballpark estimates by using, like, this force into velocity, power relationships, like, force into velocity or torque into angular velocity. These kind of power relationships you can use. So you can go directly, like, say you are given this linear stage, the force on the output side is estimated is a friction force and some inertial load force. That is estimated to be some value, and then you have some velocity, maximum velocity that is coming up in the system. So you can use maximum force and maximum velocity to get, like, the conservative estimate of total power required by the system. Okay, or one can kind of translate that into torque and angular velocity on the motor side and then do that. Okay, so wherever you do power calculations, like, you say you do, say, power calculations on the load side, if you have done by this linear stage, for example, for this linear stage, then while translating to the motor side, one can use some kind of efficiency of power transmission. Okay, so depending upon, like, friction, say, for example, in this case you have a spring loaded element that is coming up, right? So that is, you remember this stage assembly. You have the spring-loaded element which is loading onto the screw. so as to kind of prevent a backlash. Now with this spring loading, your friction will be very high in this case. So your transmission efficiency will go down because of the friction. And you need to kind of account for that while building your actuator. So right now we are thinking of using some kind of a servo motor as an actuator in this case, and this will start affecting the power required for the servo motor. Okay, so one can start with the estimates many times when you don't have an actual kind of a thing, and then so this design process or like this is a little bit an iterative. You start off with getting some kind of details, and then use those details to get to the manufacturer catalog to select a proper sensor. And once you select a sensor, you see other more details information, and then see whether that will suffice what you have made a choice. Okay, so and if it is not, then again iterate next time to kind of select other kind of specifications. Okay, so that is how the process will typically go on. And this process, you may probably need to use it in your project now. When you don't have no real choice in these sensors and actuators, we may do that. Okay, oh look, I have estimated, but I don't have whatever sensor I have is this only because of the resource constraint. Then you can say, okay, how this, suppose you select that kind of a sensor, how it will translate to the resolution or accuracy that you will achieve for your final task. Okay, so that translation that we would like to see in your project presentations and things like that. Okay, so we will select, for example, here for linear encoder we will select for this. If you are really interested in the output side positioning, and we know that there are some kind of backlash elements in the system which will affect linear to rotary part. But if we say, okay, we don't have much of a backlash, or backlash is taken care of by the spring loading, then a rotary encoder can also be sufficient, because we know that there is no uncertainty between the input and the output. Okay, so then so rotary encoder, if you want to select, then it will be much coarser resolution than a linear encoder, because there is some kind of a lead screw connection between the linear and rotary part, and for entire rotation of 360 degree on encoder side or motor side, you will have a displacement only of 1 mm on say linear side. Okay, so that is corresponding to the lead of the screw, and that's how your requirement of coarser or finer resolution will change based on where you are mounting the sensor. So you need to think, okay, what is the place that you are going to mount your sensor on, and according to that the resolutions have will change. And one has to be one needs to be a little smart to choose this properly, so that not to harm the applications also, and at the same time you don't increase the cost unnecessarily. So that's how this choice of mounting the sensor at appropriate place would have some kind of thinking required. Then as I said earlier, this we decide diameter of the lead screw and lead of the lead screw. Now this all the choice of the lead screw and the sensor, now you can see that they are coupled here. Okay, so once you choose the lead screw, a particular thing for the same application, the sensor requirements gets frozen. Or if you think, okay, no, I want to kind of have some kind of a better possibility, that I don't want to use too costly sensor here, I want to have coarser sensor used, then I can choose a lead screw which is having lesser lead than previous choice. Okay, so like that one can think about, and this is all I think the based on some kind of a simple common sense understanding of these concepts of kinematic relationships. Okay, and making use of them to think and get to what we want finally to achieve. Okay. there'll be these considerations of manufacturing and tolerances which will have some kind of a cost implications. So we need to make sure that these tolerances on manufacturing are not like, you know, directly seen on the you know, resolution that we want to achieve for the sensor. Say for example, if I want a 5 micron resolution in the motion, my manufacturing of the lead screw should have a better kind of a surface undulations than 5 micron. Okay, otherwise the surface undulations will start moving the stage there, and then like, you know, I may not get a perfect linearity that that I would look I'm looking for. Okay, so those kind of considerations will be there in addition. But this is about the surface finish. So surface finish would be most of the times like no better. Or what happens is many times as we do the operation, I mean more and more use the screw, then like no, it will get more and more smoothened, and it may get better. You might have seen, you know, your car also has this kind of a brand new purchased car, the piston and cylinder, you know, these tolerances are such that their friction is little higher, but as you kind of start using like running the car in first few months, like, you know, they get automatically better by wear, little bit of wear that is happening there. So rotary and corollary, this we talked about. Now based on the speed required, okay, the dynamic response also is important to see. So based on speed that is required, you'll have a good dynamic response estimated, like, you know, on the encoder side. So say speed is given on the load side, say lead screw x speed, we saw 20 mm per second. What it translates to on the motor side, okay, on the rotary side, which is how many pulses per second are coming, and we need to have a sensor which can give you output which is resolving those pulses nicely. Okay, so if the sensor inside is such that like the pulse has some kind of a finite rise time and like a fall time, you may not be able to kind of get those pulses nicely for very extremely high speed. Okay, so you may observe that maybe we can see, you may not, you don't have oscilloscope to observe, but we can try doing this experiment where we start running motor at pretty high speed and see that, you know, you'll find your encoder may start giving some spurious data. Okay, the data may not be completely matching what is happening there. Okay, so that kind of a scenario would happen. And at that time, if you kind of look at the signal in the oscilloscope, the pulses will not be very sharp, like square pulse, but it may be more like a, like, you know, a halfway to rise and then again fall. Okay, because the rise time and fall times, they are kind of start now merging without any flat on the complete rise may not happen there. Okay, and then you'll get a resolution. Based on the resolution, you get the resolution and range. You will get a bit accuracy for the channel, and then this dynamic. So there are some kind of a dynamic considerations for the sensor, but they are typically not so stringent. Actually, many times sensors will be responding much faster than your application requirement. But application requirement, especially if the speeds are very high. Okay, now these are relative terms. Very high, you will get to know what is very high only after like my estimation of this and like my calculation and seeing, okay, oh, these are the number of pulses coming in say one revolution. And that's why one per pulse time will be something like that. and then you estimate that per pulse time, seeing that okay, now my rise time and fall time, if they add up to the pulse time, then you'll find that okay, oh no, that encoder is now on the verge of getting worst kind of a scenario. Okay, so that needs to kind of be given some consideration. Okay, but most sensors, you'll find that this requirement is not very stringent. Okay.